point. So thank you guys for coming out. Before we get started, since we are about to busy ourselves in the words of Torah, I think we should say the blessing for literally busying ourselves in the words of Torah. It ends in La'asok b'divrei Torah. So let's try saying it together. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kitshanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu la'asok b'divrei Torah. V'tzivanu la'asok b'divrei Torah. So we have said, praise to you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who's made us holy with your commandments and commanded us to busy ourselves in the words of Torah. So we'll get down to busying ourselves. With a larger crowd, I would have had you find the person that you know the least best to be chevrita. I think we've done that already. So. The topic is social justice in the Siddur. The way I prepared this is, again, assuming many chevritas, I have 10 texts from the Siddur and guiding questions to discuss those texts. Fortunately, I also have a condensed packet of all of them so that people can take them home at the end. So I suggest that we have a discussion.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So, too bad there's not a woman for it. Whatever. All right. So let's start with this first text. Which is a quote from the Talmud. Some Siddurim put this text in as a replacement for the description of the sacrifices that we read about in Birkat HaShachar in the beginning of our morning services. Becca, do you want to read it?
In English?
In English.
Okay.
There aren't vowels. There aren't even vowels, and it's not Hebrew, so I wouldn't ask you to read it.
Okay. I feel better. And Rabbi Hama, son of Rabbi Hanina, says, "What is the meaning of that which is written? After the Lord your God shall you walk, and him shall you fear, and his commandments shall you keep. And unto his voice shall you hearken, and him shall you serve, and unto him shall you cleave." But is it actually possible for a person to follow the divine presence? But hasn't it already been stated, "For the Lord your God is a devouring fire, a jealous God, and one cannot approach fire"? He explains, "Rather the meaning of this, that one should follow the attributes of the Holy One, blessed be He." He provides several examples. Just as he clothed the naked, as it is written, "And the Lord God made for Adam and his wife garments of skin and clothed them," so too should you clothe the naked. Just as the Holy One, blessed be He, visits the sick, as it is written with regard to God's appearing to Abraham following his circumcision, and the Lord appears unto him by the terebinths of Mamre, so too shall you visit the sick. Just as the Holy One, blessed be He, consoles mourners, as it is written, "And it came to pass after the death of Abraham that God blessed Isaac his son," so too should you console mourners. Just as the Holy One, blessed be He, buried the dead, as it is written, "And he was buried in the valley of the land of Moab, so too shall you bury the dead."
Thank you. So, to summarize, we're looking at a verse in the Torah where it says, "After the Lord your God shall you walk." And the rabbis are wondering, how can you follow God? Because there's another verse that says, God is a devouring fire. And therefore, if you can't approach fire, if you can't like walk after fire, and fire equals God, how can you walk after God? So then they say that you should follow the things that God does. And it gives several examples. God made clothes for Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. God visited the sick when God visited Abraham with the three angels. God consults the mourners. And it gives an example after Abraham died, God visited Isaac, and God buries the dead when God buried Moses. So the question is, what does this text tell us about the relationship between how God behaves and how we should behave?
We
should behave like God. Yep. Okay, good.
I like how you started with something that, like, you know, gonna ramp up, but
yes.
I'll get that. Yes.
We start with a soft one. Okay. Marilyn, would you like to read the next text at the bottom of page 1?
Mishnah Piyah, chapter 1, verse 1. These are the things that have no measure. Piyah, corner of the field, which, while harvesting, must be left for the poor. Bikurim, first fruits that must be brought to the temple and given to the priest. The appearance sacrifice brought to the temple on pilgrimage festival, acts of kindness, and the study of Torah. These are the things, the fruits of which a man enjoys in this world, while the principle remains for him in the world to come. Honoring one's father and mother, acts of kindness, bringing peace between a man and his fellow. But the story of Torah is equal to them all.
Thank you. So this comes from the Mishnah. The Mishnah is a set of discussions about how to take what's in the Torah and apply it to the situation that the Jews found themselves in after the Torah was written as they moved to urban contexts. And after many, many years of discussions and precedent law cases, these got written down around the year 200 and organized. And we sing about these every Passover when we say, who knows when, and it's six are the orders of the Mishnah, six of the categories. So the orders of the Mishnah are broken down into tractates, into books, and one of them is called Peah. Peah is one of the rules in the Torah that when you are harvesting your field, you're supposed to leave the corners of your field so that the poor can come and gather. So
it doesn't say how big the corners should be.
Exactly. So that's, so Peah gets its own book, and this is the very beginning of it. In general, the rabbis are very concerned about quantities. They like numbers. How much of this, how much of that, what about this, what about that? And here they tell us there are a few things that actually have no measure. You can do as much as you want with them. And it lists the things that you read. And then it goes on to say that there are other things which you enjoy the reward now, but also in the world to come, whatever that means. And then it lists more things. So that's that text. Okay. Everybody want to read the next text at the top of page 2?
These are the deeds?
Yep.
Okay. These are the deeds that yield immediate fruit and continue to yield fruit in time to come. Honoring parents, doing deeds of loving kindness, attending the house of study, punctually, morning and evening. Providing hospitality, visiting the sick, helping the needy bride, attending the dead, probing the meaning of prayer, making peace between one person and another, and between husband and wife, the study of Torah is equal to them all.
Great, thank you. So this is a quote from the Talmud, kind of. It's not actually in the Talmud in this form. It's rearranged a little bit, and maybe some stuff is added, and I will give credit to the Talmud that there might be more details I was not able to find that make it actually work as it is attributed. But most of it's in the Talmud. The Talmud being the further discussions about the Mishnah as previously discussed. So those discussions got written down in the Gemara, and Mishnah plus Gemara equals Talmud. So these are more examples of the things that have that quote yield immediate fruit. So you get immediate reward, and then there's more fruit, more reward in the time to come. Again, whatever that means. And it's another list. So the first question would be, what do these two texts have in common?
The flow of mitzvahs.
Do you mean precisely, like which are in common, or do you mean more thematically?
Both.
For the sake of time, we can go with more thematically.
Okay, so they're mitzvahs. They're all...
The touch of parents.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's interesting, and maybe I didn't read something correctly, but the first one talks about the Bikurim, the first fruits coming, and maybe it's in the translation, but in the second one it doesn't talk specifically about the Bikurim, but it says to yield fruit in the time to come, so in the immediate fruit.
That's good.
Interesting.
But it brings it up, and again, I did not pay attention to the Hebrew to see if it's just a translation thing, but the idea
that's
of fruit
good,
comes
good.
Up.
That's good.
In
yeah.
both.
Good connection.
And they both end with Torah.
Yeah. What about Torah?
The study of Torah.
Go ahead.
Is equal to them all.
No, I have a problem with that. Because same person doesn't honor their parents, but they study Torah. They're not a good person.
Have you met their parents?
I don't have anybody in particular in
mind.
It's a good question.
It's equal to them all doesn't necessarily mean that it can replace them all. It just means that its value is...
As important,
right? Because I think you're right, right? If you study Torah, but you're a scoundrel, it's not... I don't think that's the goal.
I also think, so in the first one, it says bringing peace between a man and his fellow, and in the second one, it says making peace between one person and another, and between specifically husband and wife. So, just so that. I think.
It's added, yeah.
Yeah.
There's an added line there, not the second one. Well, somebody's spouse is also another person.
Right? Yeah, no, I'm just, like, I think attending to the dead didn't pop up, no pun intended, in the first one. I mean, it does show up in the first reading we looked at, but not everything in, what is this, in the Mishnah piece shows up in the Siddur piece, and that one showed up in both.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think if there's like a commonality between all of the mitzvot that are listed here. It's about paying attention to relationship, relationship to other people, and relationship to God. Like that's these are all things that take you out of yourself and require you to be attentive to others. And the others again are your spouse, other people, neighbors, your community, and then also, right, coming to shul, focusing on prayer. Cultivating a rich spiritual life, a life of learning Torah. So it's I don't know, maybe that, if that's maybe a little too vague, but
I don't think like doing good for good's sake. That it's not about like what you, the return is intangible.
Yeah,
even when it says attending the house of study punctually morning and evening, if the house of study assumes that you are working with a partner to learn together, then you need to attend, you need to be there like on time. That is a matter of, that is an interrelational, interpersonal.
Yeah, or you're, there's a minion in your prayer.
There's a sermon right there for all the latecomers to show. You know?
There's already an UI talk actually about that, about Jewish time and how on the one hand we culturally work out like being Jewish time means being late, but on the other hand, as a religion, we're very concerned about the exact time for things.
Interesting. That's
Mainly the time we get to finally eat.
Yes.
That's a big one for us.
Yes, yes, we are into eating. Let's go on to the second question. These texts are in the Siddur right at the beginning, even before Birkat HaShachar, which is the first big prayer we say. Why do we say them before anything else, even before putting on our talis and tefillin?
They're that important. It's a short list, but it's an important list.
The third one, I didn't realize there was a difference for men and women.
And the next text.
Well, then of course.
Are you skipping ahead?
Oh, yeah. I see what you're talking about. We'll get to it.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like there's a technical answer, right? I mean, we say Birkat HaTorah really, really early because everything else is reciting Psukim, and scripture is part of prayer, and prayer and reciting Torah and prayer are kind of very related, and so much of prayer is made up of the building blocks of prayer, often scriptural verses, and so we say the Torah blessing beforehand. Once you say the Torah blessing, you have to say some Torah right afterwards. All these texts are texts in praise of Torah study, so we'll say them right after we say the Torah blessings. That's like a very technical answer.
Yeah.
I feel like you're pushing us to say something maybe beyond that. So having been so pushed, I given that there could have been anything that's there, why these? So I guess then if, you know, I think it's a lot of getting out of oneself. Like when you're in bed, that's like the most, you know, isolated one can be, and now you're up and out and your day is beginning, and so I guess like these orienting texts are kind of orienting you to like the tasks to accomplish during the day, and that your religious life is rooted in this, you know, of the people and the first, the Talmud Talmudic passage from Sota about imitating God through our like the closest we can come to walking in God's ways is by like cultivating these have practice of care for other people, so.
Yeah. So, Marilyn, go ahead.
So, is there, it's been a long time since I've looked at, I'll be honest, I'm not, you can't tell
who I am. No, the camera's not focused on you, so
you're
totally anonymous, so don't worry about it.
Anonymity is my friend. But I feel like a lot of the prayers that we say are thanking God for things that we have, and for talking about God's majesty.
Mm-hmm.
And this is not that. This is like the meat and potatoes of being a good person. So I really like what you said about how we have to remember that we're really part of this community and that we have obligations once we get out of bed. And, you know, some of us, you check your cell phone while you're still in bed and you have obligations already. But I like that. And I also think that it's before you get into the, like, God is so wonderful and thank you for making it rain stuff.
Yeah, there are some communities, I think some of the Sephardic communities, they have, and I wonder where it is, and I don't know if you've seen this, we could check, but where in the Siddur before or after this point, they encourage people to say, Hareni mekabel alai, and Mitzvah HaBarei, behold, at this point, I accept upon myself the mitzvah of my Creator, of Yahav Shereich HaKumach, and you shall love your fellow as yourself. And they sort of recite that very, very early in the Siddur, actually, like the first pages in some of the Sephardic customs. That's also like very much fitting into this ethos. So it's really, I think it's a beautiful practice.
Yeah.
Oh, you already did number three. The third question?
Yeah. Tell you our basic, yeah.
So, which is more important, study or action? So Sounds like you're already having a
say the action.
Mm-hmm. I will say that I'm not Shomer Shabbos. My line is I like to do something during Shabbos to note that it is different from my other days. Maybe that's lighting candles, maybe it's Kiddush. You know, my grandparents have been in the hospital lately. And so I go there. And you know what? I think that that is better for, like, spirituality than showing up here. If it's like you could go to shul or you could go say hi to them at the hospital, I'm going to the hospital. Like, so I'm going to go with the action. If they weren't in the hospital, would I show up to shul?
Remind me to tell you about something like that afterwards.
Okay.
About sweat. So this question is actually discussed in the Talmud, which is more important, study or action? And the answer that they come up with after various esteemed rabbis present arguments for study and various esteemed rabbis present arguments for action is that study is more important, but only if it leads to action.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an interesting idea, mm-hmm. A decent compromise.
Like that.
Let's look at the fourth question. How is it that certain actions yield fruit now and also after you die?
Is it because if I do a good deed,
mm-hmm.
It like lives on?
Mm-hmm. That makes sense. You have a thought?
Yields fruit now because you might actually be helping people
mm-hmm.
by doing these things.
Yeah.
And the way I look at it, your good deeds are on one side of the scale,
mm-hmm.
and your sins are on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
So when you do good deeds, you know, it'll give you credit for the world to come.
That makes sense. Yeah. And the nice thing about Jewish tradition is, I can say, you're both probably right. They are not mutually exclusive.
I had a teacher once talked about, I know that Jews, like, there is talk of the afterlife, but it's not, so my teacher spoke about how the devil and the idea of hell for Christians really didn't come about until they realized you needed the fear.
Mm-hmm.
And so I always describe, you know, Judaism, we believe in doing good for good's sake, not mm-hmm. to save your soul in the kingdom to come.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, I'm not here to make sure that I have, I don't know that there is one, I don't know that I'm going to a good one, whatever mm-hmm. it is, but that you do good to enjoy the fruits now.
Yep.
And not because you don't want to literally be damned to hell. And I like that about Judaism.
It's a good religion. And a good culture. All right. Question number 5. What are some actions you could work into your current routine based on these texts from the Siddur?
Say what? Sorry.
No worries. Question number 5. What are some actions you can work into your current routine based on these texts from the Siddur?
Oh, visiting yourself. I was actually going to do it last
mm-hmm.
week, but I had a cold,
mm-hmm.
so it wouldn't have been a good thing.
That was your gift, was not going, see? I'm serious,
yeah.
I mean.
Yep.
Not to expose these two people to my cold.
I've been thinking, I've been toying with the idea for like about 6 months or so of not using my phone as an alarm clock, so
mm-hmm.
that it sort of delays my checking email and
yeah.
like plugging in and just everything, you know, until later, because like just that, all of these are, you know, this is an importance. Like, what are the first things you say in the morning? Like, what are the first things you think about in the morning? What, like, how do you establish your priorities for the day?
Mm-hmm.
And like, this is the way that over thousands of years our people have like thought of that question, and like, let's say, you know, with the kids, and the, you know, like, I could wake up at, you know, 5:45, whatever. I'm not like in shul and for another hour or more, you know, so just in Shabbat until much later, and so it's a big.
I think what you do is you set your Monday alarm to be the first thing on the list. You know how you can write in something? Mine says good morning, that's what my alarm says to me. And on Tuesday you put the next thing on the list, and so on and so forth.
Yeah. That's good.
I was kind of teasing, but it's a way of incorporating it.
It's not a bad idea.
I started using my phone as an alarm before Rosh Hashanah because I wasn't getting up at the same time every day. Rosh Hashanah ended up being sick. I couldn't really show, but and the for some days I came earlier in Yom Tov than I come on Shabbat. But I don't touch that phone. It's on top of my chest of drawers, and so I don't see anything wrong in using it as an alarm.
No.
And I'm not, I don't have a smartphone, so I wouldn't be checking my email anyhow.
Yeah. I think then, for you, unlike the rabbi, since he has a smartphone, I think for him, if he didn't have a smartphone, he wouldn't have a problem with using it as his alarm clock, because it wouldn't tempt him into immediately checking email.
Although, if he used it on Shabbat, I don't think he'd check his email.
No, he wouldn't check his email on Shabbat, no.
It's just during the week when you should be
davening,
you want to check your email first.
Right.
Like, I know somebody whose name I won't mention, says during the week that he's got TV on while he's davening.
Yep. All right, so we've already spent about half of our time on one set of texts, which is good. It's good to have an in-depth discussion. So rather than push us through a whole set of other texts in not very much time, I'm going to skip almost all of them, and we can come back to these texts later.
Okay, where are
but
we going?
I'm going to bring us all the way to page 9.
This is like during the high holidays where there's like a page skip and you're like, yes!
Yes, well.
I get to answer.
Think of this more like checkers. I could go backwards. All right. So this is the first paragraph and the last paragraph of Birkat HaMazon, the first like full paragraph. Becca, do you want to read the first one?
Sure. Praised are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who in goodness feeds the whole world with grace, kindness, and compassion. God gives food to all living things, for God's kindness is forever. Because of God's continual great goodness, we have never lacked for food, nor may we ever lack for it. For the sake of God's great name, for God feeds and sustains all, does good to all, and prepares food for all of God's creations. Praised are you, Lord, who feeds everybody.
Thank you. Amber, do you want to read the next one?
Sure. I revere the Lord, you who are God's holy ones. For those who revere God lack nothing. Scoffers may suffer starvation, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Praise the Lord, for God is good. God's love endures forever. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. Blessed is the person who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is in the Lord alone. Once I was young and I am old. I have never seen a righteous person forsaken, allowed their children to go begging for bread. May the Lord give God's people strength. May the Lord bless God's people with peace.
I just tell you, in the wake of everything in like Puerto Rico, it makes me not really believe it.
Yeah, I mean, there's people in the third world that are starving.
And I love Birkat, okay? It's one of my favorite prayers. But.
So you've actually just hit on the first question. Prescient you are.
I'm so smart. I'll tell my mom later today. She'll be so impressed.
You want to read the first question?
These are the beginning and ending paragraphs of Birkat HaMazon, the blessings we say after we eat. At the end of the first paragraph, we bless God who feeds everybody. How do you reconcile these words with the fact that there are clearly people without enough food?
Oh, that is the question.
I apologize. I'm trying to look at what's there.
Yeah.
I just told them and they said, they think it's good fat. But I said,
do you have thoughts on this?
Did they tell you where it was?
I can't reconcile it.
He said he was cold and missed the delivery service.
I do believe there's enough food in the world to feed everybody. It's just getting it to them and then paying for it.
Mm-hmm. So that might be, if there is an answer, that might be the only way of thinking about it, that God provides enough food.
I don't know how much you know about the origin of birkat, but like, for me to say, did the rabbis really believe this? Like, when they wrote it? Because there has been no point in time where everybody was fed, and there's no point in time where rabbis thought that everybody was fed, okay? Like, let's be honest, we probably feed more percentage-wise of the world today than we ever have.
Right.
And it's not like some rabbi in a shuttle was like, well, everybody in my shuttle is eating, so, you know, clearly we can write that God feeds everybody. So it's just, you know, watching the news is heartbreaking lately.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure it's always heartbreaking, but it feels worse recently. And, yeah, I have trouble reconciling that.
So, the previous text is about Moses. Let's jump backwards to Motzi, and then we'll jump forwards to Birkat, and in between we will not actually eat.
Did you solve
it?
We are jumping backwards to Motzi in order to go forwards to Birkat,
cool. Yeah.
But there is no food in between. All right, so bottom of page 8. Marilyn, do you want to read the text?
Praised are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth.
Great, thank you. All right, and the only question on this one we're going to do is number 1 at the bottom of page 8. Can you read that question, please?
God alone does not bring bread from the earth. We are partners with God in this endeavor. What are other ways in which we are partners with God?
Mm.
Doctors, healing the sick.
Mm.
Taking care of each other.
Mm-hmm.
What were all those things that God did in the first reading that we're supposed to follow in his footsteps? Clothing the naked, visiting the sick. Visiting the mourners.
That's different from, and it's different from the other brachot.
Mm-hmm.
Speak about God as creator,
mm-hmm.
which is not something that we're not part now.
Yeah.
Right. But God creates the fruit. We don't do that. But motzi lechem in haaretz, that is something that we're involved. That's very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So it is different.
So you wanted us to get the. You know, I teach, and sometimes you have time constraints, and you're like, okay, we have to go through step 5, and then you realize, oh, stinker, we actually need 4 in order to make 5 work. So we just had that moment where we had to go back to do that we are the go-between.
Very good.
You're very proud of yourself.
Oh,
good job. Good job. Well done.
Thank you. So, back in Birkat now, on page 9.
A nice assist.
For me, with question number 1, like, on the surface there, where it says, praise to you, God who feeds everybody, like, it is clearly incompatible with reality as we know it. And the only way that I have found that I can honestly say these words and mean them is the idea that God provides enough food for everybody, the promised distribution. and that's up to us. When you couple the amount of hunger in the world with the amount of food waste, particularly in this country, if it were better handled, we could do a better job with that. So let's look at number two. At the end of the last paragraph, so the second text, we say, "Once I was young and now I'm old, yet I've never watched a righteous person forsaken and allowed their children to go begging for bread," which in Hebrew is nar hayiti, et cetera, et cetera. It is offensive to say that all homeless people are bad people. Should the words in this prayer be read descriptively or prescriptively?
So I do have to say, like, it bothers me when people find success and they're like, I believe in thanking God, but mm-hmm. then when they're like, this is God's will, I think that is such a bunch of hooey, because it is not God's will that this person should be beaten. It is not God's will that good things happen sometimes to bad people or mediocre people, and bad things happen to people who are also mediocre or possibly good. And you know, like I get that we should thank God, and I do. Okay, I really. Mm-hmm. I do, and I have had a very wonderful existence, but does that mean a homeless person is a bad person? Clearly no.
It's a curious line. I thought the world as it should be, or it's like how things ought to be.
Mm-hmm.
And what's it doing here? Where's it from? Like, what is this paragraph? Like, what's the whole series of like phrases all about like bounty and wealth and prosperity for people who are good, and you know, and that there's like, and it's sort of a, it's like a vision of justice and bounty that clearly is not a description of the world as it is, but it's sort of like a vision of the world. And so it's just odd it's phrased that way, because somebody, you know, like this line seems to be saying this is what I've seen in the world, whereas the other sentences are not like that.
Yeah.
So it sort of sharpens it, but.
Yeah,
it's like the type of thing when we want to say, make a statement like this, that would be just and expected.
I was saying the Pledge of Allegiance this morning with my class, and I thought the same thing. It's this is what we aim for, and we are aiming for the
you
more
know,
perfect
you know, I,
and all that.
And it's even, you know, I just reminded me, I read recently, somebody pointed out that the Star Spangled Banner ends with a question mark.
Hmm.
Oh, say, does that Star-Spangled Banner get waved, right?
Yeah.
It's a question, like, is this still happening, right? It's like, describes this moment, flag was still there, blah, 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 right? And then, oh, say, does that Star-Spangled still, you know, like how is the country going? How is the Union going? How fares the Union? Is the flag still waving, home of the brave, right? And that's, so it sort of introduces a kind of tentativeness and a kind of, like, sort of puts a little bit of the, I think it makes the whole song much more
continuous.
Like tolerable. Like it's not about sort of blind patriotism. It's about like we have to, like it's a little bit on us to make sure that, you know, that freedom endures, etc. You know, so I don't know. Maybe you want to like kind of bring that narrative to the Gamzakanti. It's not a objective description of the world. It's a vision of what like we should be able to say. Can we say this? You know.
Mm-hmm.
Can we live our lives, you know, from youth to old age, and see people who are good, you know, being rewarded by having, you know, food security and you know, so.
So it sounds like you're coming down on the side of prescriptive.
Yeah.
Should be
yeah.
A prescription for the future.
Or even a prayer.
Yeah. That's for someone.
What? A prayer?
So, any of these verses could have been arranged in any order in this paragraph. Why do you think that the words that we were just talking about are immediately followed by "May the Lord give God's people strength"?
Well, if we're the go-between,
mm-hmm.
to get the bounty of food to the people who need it,
mm-hmm.
then we need strength.
Very nice.
Yeah.
It sort of takes the feeling of the gratitude we feel at the end of the meal and turns it to a moment of a galvanizing
charge.
Moment. Yeah, exactly. Like now make sure that others also have the same satiation.
Yeah.
Do
you
have
thoughts?
Now you make me feel like after I say Berakat Hamazon, I'm supposed to take my leftovers and find the homeless person down the street.
So maybe, and also maybe before you can sit down, you should make sure, who have you invited to your table to join you, and what have you done to take care of the community and other things. So.
So on the next page, how does Sota 14a, which would be the first thing that we read, inform your reading of this book?
So it's the same, I guess the same point the early one, like the religious quest includes this interpersonal, ethical care for other people, like imitating God's concerns and imitating God's actions. That's how we walk in God's ways. And it doesn't say feeding the hungry here, but we did say "Potechet Yadecha," it's like God opens God's hand and sustains all the new things, and that should be something we should emulate as well. And maybe even we have to, because God's counting on us to make sure that everyone gets that.
Yeah. What about you, Rebecca? You can use the first or the second paragraph to think about your answer.
I was finally not going to answer a question.
You are allowed to pass.
So the first reading didn't talk specifically about food.
Mm-hmm.
It really talked about mimicking God.
Mm-hmm.
The Birkat talks about God's great goodness and kindness. Kind of if you take out the food from Birkat Hamazon, even though that's what the prayer is about, you're almost left with a skeleton of what the first one is, I would say.
Interesting.
The first one's a little more specific, but just the idea of being good.
Yeah. There actually is quite a bit in Birkat Hamazon besides food.
Mm-hmm.
The rabbis were like, we can force them to say these words three times a day, so let's talk about a whole slew of other things, including Jerusalem, because we want you to think about Jerusalem at least three times a day. But food is the ostensible reason that we are saying this. What about you, Marilyn?
Well, I think we're imitating God.
Mm-hmm.
By providing food for needy people,
mm-hmm.
even though it's not specifically mentioned in Sota 14a.
Yeah. And it's not mentioned in Sota 14a. Sota 14a talks about what God does we should do.
Mm-hmm.
And then in Birkat it says, praise to you, Lord, who feeds everybody. So if God is the one that feeds everybody, and we should be like God, ergo.
Then we should be feeding.
Well, we should be partners with God.
And we should partner with God, yes.
Well,
yeah, because we don't get the bread and the ground like manna.
Right. Right. All right, so finally, question five. What are some actions you can work into your current routine based on this text from the Siddur?
Well, today I just ordered a check for my philanthropic fund to the ARC. They have this Hanukkah wishes, so I designated an amount for gift cards and also an amount for the food pantry.
Oh, great. That's a good thing to do.
I have this box in my classroom I started this year. So my school recently started giving out free breakfast and lunch, and they're already pre-made bags. And the kids, of course, aren't going to eat everything that's in there. So I took this little cardboard box and I wrote free food on it because I can't stand food going in the garbage. And every day, if there's like an apple you don't want or a string cheese, whatever it is, you put it in the free food box, and anyone can come at any time. And if you want something from there, you can take. And if you have something, you
get. How does that work? How does that work?
We're on like day five, but I have to say, sometimes the kids come in, they go, "All there is mustard."
there is a institution in yeshivas. They call this the hefker table.
Okay.
Which is where if you have food that you, like leftovers, or like you don't you make it hefker, you say it's ownerless, and you have a little corner somewhere in the building, and you just leave your things there. And every good yeshiva should have a hefker table where you can rummage and find some snacks if you're hungry, or whatever people bring. I've had occasion to visit, you know, Yeshiva University, their main campus in New York has a very impressive hefker table, especially... Like,
is there a refrigerated section?
No, especially after weekends, and people bring like you know, lots of Shabbos leftovers and bring it. I have a friend who years ago said to me, you know, it disproves the rule that beggars can't be choosers if you, because there's like whatever. But okay. Anyway, so
look at that. That's what I've got.
That's very nice.
And yesterday it was two apples and two fruit punches after first hour, and by the end of third hour there was no food. So
that's very nice. That's right.
I always try, like, when I go out to eat, I'm a big eater of leftovers. I actually usually like the food more the day after when it's cold, quite frankly. But if it's stuff that I'm not going to eat, or if it's not my food and somebody just ended up giving me their leftovers too, then somebody told me if you put it next to a garbage can in the city, in an area where you know there's going to be homeless people walking around, if you put it next to the garbage can, then that is... So that's where the homeless person will look.
Well, Bob Barsky, when he goes to Sudach Lishi, if there is tuna or egg salad left, he brings it to some homeless people.
Mm-hmm. That's a good idea.
We did my family synagogue in the suburbs. My sister's birthday every year, we do those Thanksgiving care packages. And I have to say, explaining, last year my nephew was old enough, he was four, and he finally asked, you know, why do we do this? And explaining to a four-year-old that not everybody's kitchen has food in it. You know, it was like you had to do it in a way that didn't overwhelm him, but also made him feel grateful. You know, there's a balance there. Good things to do.
It's interesting. I was wondering what, Right, so it's, again, think of like as a religious moment, right? So we enact this religious ritual. We say Birkat HaMazon. It's long, and it should be long, right? If you actually pay attention, it's long. So we're cultivating this awareness, as you suggested, that we are to imitate God in our concern that all living things have sustenance. And so we're setting God on his own. Among the things that it's supposed to make us think about, that's one of the things it makes us think about. I just wonder how that connects to some of the other like themes of gratitude, right? No delicha, we've got, you know, the how does that awareness relate to the awareness of gratitude, which is like maybe more classic like theme of Rakatana of, you know, so. I think maybe gratitude comes from a recognition that I have things that I don't deserve, or maybe other people who deserve it equally to me don't have it, and or the tenuousness of what I have. I think maybe those are all kind of the awarenesses that give rise to gratitude.
So that is a excellent segue. Because we are coming close to the end of our time, and I want to be respectful of your time, so I want to express my gratitude to you guys for coming out. I know you could have been watching the Cubs or doing a variety of other things, but you came. There are 8 other texts that we did not get to that are in this packet. There are 5 questions for each prayer. Each set of questions ends with referring back to the first text and using that as a lens. And then thinking about actions that you could take based off of your thinkings. So you're welcome to peruse this on your own time, and if you have further questions, you know how to find me. But I will give you one more sheet with all the other prayers from the Siddur that I did not put in this packet.
Can I ask then, before you do that, maybe just like a quick methodological question. Going through the Siddur, I guess, as a user of a Siddur, did these jump out at you, or is your contention that like you can open the Siddur to any page and engage in this kind of social justice analysis?
My contention would be that any prayer could be read in a social justice sort of way. Some of them are easier to do that than others. Sometimes the gold nuggets are on the surface, sometimes you have to dig for them. Mm-hmm. The lens of imitatio Dei, of imitating God, which is our Jewish source text, is this one that's at the beginning, helps to make that easier to do, that just like God redeems people, mm-hmm. Israel and Michamacha, for instance, so too we can do like God, we can be like God. Mm-hmm. So I gave you the most obvious ones, and I will give you a list with the next most obvious ones, but you can, if you think about any prayer in that sort of way, you can come up with your own connections.
Yes, sure, come on.
Thank you.
Thank you.